There she is. Hi, Belen, how are you?
I didn't hear you guys.
I said, there she is.
Oh, yeah. Hi, guys. Yes, of course I'm here. Sorry for the delay. Yes.
No worries. So we will get started very shortly. I usually wait about 2 to 3 minutes. Letting people log on. Heba, who is in the background, will let me know when we should commence. In the meantime, let me know if you guys could hear. I always like to put a little music in the background. All right, we'll wait 1 more minute and then we will kick things off. All right. Good evening, everyone. My name is Nicolas Krohne Vargas. My pronouns are he, him, él. I am the chair of membership for the Loyola University Latino Alumni Board. I'm delighted to be part of this event today. LULAB, we are focused on creating opportunities for members of our community to connect. As a leadership team, we've been really focused over the last 18 months on living out our mission. And that is creating value for our community of alumni, as well as current students, and showcasing their stories. We are all about personal and professional development. And we have started organizing these leadership speaker series or fireside chats that are really centered around professional themes. In the past, we've hosted several panels on different topics, such as a path to leadership, As well as last year, early in the year, we hosted a panel on entrepreneurship and the fact that there's like 8 out of 10 new businesses in America are started by Latina communities. So today, I'm delighted to speak to a group of distinguished panelists, three Latinas and Loyola students, trailblazers, who have been recognized as Loyola President Medallion recipients. Just a little bit of background context on what is the President's Medallion Award. Loyola University of Chicago has awarded the President's Medallion annually to its most outstanding students for almost 50 years. The President's Medallion is one of the most prestigious awards conferred by the university. A medallion is presented to a single student in each college, school, or institute of the university each year. And so, what a treat to have three Latinas be selected this past year. Some of the criteria includes being ranked academically in the top quarter of their class. They must exemplify a combination of outstanding scholarship, leadership, and service. They obviously have to be a person of integrity and good reputation. And they must manifest leadership in serving others through involvement in student organizations or volunteering in community settings. So now for some introductions. Chisa Santiago plans to use her degree from Loyola to advance her career as a Chicago Police Department officer and identify pathways to break down barriers in equity. Chisa collaborates with the community to develop activities such as prayer circles, beautification projects, and resource fairs that foster positive interactions between police and local neighborhoods. She's a lifelong learner. Chisa is considering earning a master's degree to broaden her social impact. Welcome, Chisa.
Thank you, Nico. Thank you for having me.
All right. Belen Morales, born in Quito, Ecuador, is a dedicated volunteer for several organizations that help the less fortunate and is a known advocate leader amongst the Latina, Latino, Latine community. Through the support of Institute of Pastoral Studies faculty, scholarship awards, and inspiration from her mother, Belen made an impact beyond the classroom in the form of grant projects, community outreach, and by strengthening the university's relationship with the Vatican through her involvement in an international developmental program. She plans to further her education career, pursuing a PhD in inclusive and sustainable development. Bienvenida, Belen.
Muchas gracias, Nicolás. I am honored to be here.
Born and raised in Colombia, Juanita Vivas Bastidas is passionate about examining how people experience race, gender, nation, and citizenship in the context of migration, mental health, and environmental inequality. As a graduate research assistant, she co-authored How Local Perceptions Contribute to the Urban Environmental Activism, which was published in the Sociological Quarterly. Inspired by her experiences as an immigrant, Juanita wants to study how Latine immigrants in Chicago appraise and cope with neighborhood stressors for her dissertation. She plans to put her skills to the service of students and the community as a faculty member and researcher. Welcome, Juanita.
Buenas noches, everyone. Thank you, Nicolas, for that introduction.
Not at all. So let's get started. I really would like to just start off by hearing more about your stories, your career aspirations, and educational pursuits that led you to where you are today. Why don't we go ahead and kick things off with Juanita?
Thank you, Nicolas. Yeah, that's a great intro question. Let me tell you a bit about my story and then we can get into my aspirations. So I was born and raised in Bogota, Colombia, as Nico mentioned. When I was about 19 years old, I was awarded a scholarship to study in a university in the United States, and that made complete sense. And at the time, my family was struggling a bit with our financial situation, so I just needed kind of a scholarship to be able to complete my BA. And so I ended up coming to Dubuque, Iowa, for my bachelor's degree.
And as I kind of mentioned to some of my other panelists, that first 4 years of the experience in the United States were a shock, a culture shock. I came from a huge city to a town, a small town in Iowa, that didn't have a lot of immigrants, that didn't have a lot of students of color. So it was a shock to say the least, and it was a lot of me feeling kind of out of place. So I knew that when I graduated, I wanted to be in a bigger city with more immigrants. And so when I graduated, my partner and I made the decision to come to Chicago. And I knew too that I wanted to pursue graduate school. But it was a matter of figuring out my visa situation, because as I mentioned, I was an immigrant student at the moment. And so I needed to figure out a way to sponsor my visa for me to either get into higher education or just start working. So for the first couple of years in Chicago, I worked. And I feel like the company took too long to let me know that they couldn't sponsor my visa. But luckily I was applying to different schools at the time, and I was accepted at a couple of ones, but I decided that Loyola University of Chicago made the most sense. And so I started with the master's degree, and then my first year, I knew that I wanted to get the PhD. And so I applied for the PhD. I was accepted to the PhD program. And so within the program, a lot of my research, as Nika mentioned, has been kind of rooted in my own experiences as an immigrant. So for instance, for my master's thesis, a lot of the work that I was doing had to do with how immigrants continue to develop ethno-racial identities once they move from their country of origin to the country of destination. So I was working with a lot of immigrant women. And now for my dissertation, I want to work looking at one particular Latino barrio in Chicago to understand how people are appraising neighborhood stressors. Because for a long time, I've been focusing specifically on environmental injustice. And so in a city like Chicago, and a lot of cities in the United States, it ends up being the case that environmental racism is specifically affecting Black and Latina communities. And so I think that that's kind of where I'm merging all of my interests. And in terms of just educational or aspirations for my career, I would love to be a professor. I think a school like Loyola that is like, that has such a specific kind of emphasis on seeing people as whole, and that has such kind of a social justice lens to the way that we approach teaching, to the way that we approach our research, would be kind of like the ideal fit for me. But yeah, just teaching and conducting research would be my plan for my career. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Let's go ahead and pivot over to Belen.
Hi, everybody. Thank you, Nicolas. Thank you, Juanita. Yes, well, a little bit about myself. I was born in Quito, Ecuador, as you mentioned, Nicolas. Since I was a kid, my parents like inculcated in me values and principles that allowed me to develop at an early age a social conscience and an interest in politics, actually. So my family and I moved to the United States when I was 13. And when I came here, I went straight to high school. So I was probably one of the youngest of my class. In high school here, a whole new world opened up for me, meeting people from all over the world. And there I began to fall in love with languages and to develop a vocation to help as many people as possible. For this reason, I decided to study political science in college. So I went for my first 2 years of college to Dominican University, and then I transferred to UIC, the University of Illinois at Chicago, and I added economics as my second major. So during college, I had the opportunity to be an intern at the Consulate of Ecuador here in Chicago, and I graduated in 2015. So after college, I also interned at a congressional office. And right after that, I became an international volunteer with Vives USA for roughly a year. I chose to go volunteer for a year to my country, Ecuador, because it was 2016 and Ecuador had had a devastating earthquake that year. So I wanted to go help there. I ended up not going to the area of the earthquake, but I went to a coastal city called Guayaquil, and I served for half of the time in a low-income school where I got to live in community with sisters, admirable women. And for the second part of my volunteer service, I was actually in the Amazon, the Ecuadorian Amazon, in a rural community where I got to learn more about my own Ecuadorian indigenous identity. And I became much closer with God in a way that I hadn't experienced before. Little did I know, God was preparing me for my next mission. And here's a turning point in my life that I would like to share. Right before the ending of my volunteer service, my mom fell ill with a brain tumor. And from one day to another, I was back here in Chicago at the bedside of a hospital room. My mom was diagnosed with brain cancer, and that was my next mission. I began to be my mother's full-time caregiver at 23. And I had the blessing to accompany her through her treatment, therapies, and everything for 5 years and a half until my dad retired and was able to help me out and took over for her care. So, you know, my life, my family has been a pillar through this all. During the time when I was my mother's caregiver, I was able to have a part-time job at the Pastoral Migratoria, the Immigration Ministry of the Archdiocese of Chicago, where I was able to accompany ministries and leaders of parishes to organize several activities for the migrant community. And at the same time, after I worked for 3 years in Pastoral Migratoria, I started my studies at Loyola University in my master's in social justice, which coincided very well with already my vocation to social justice. And well, now, one of the things that I've done and I'm proud of is organizing two rallies here in Chicago in support of indigenous Ecuadorians, our indigenous community, especially in 2019 and 2021, when Ecuador was living austerity measures by two authoritarian right-wing governments. And I was able to organize these two rallies here in Chicago. Now, besides being a student at the IPS, I am a graduate assistant. And through my work, I was able to participate and carry out an international project in partnership with the Pontifical Commission for Latin America, with other six universities, Jesuit universities from Latin America. And I am conducting projects with the Miguel Pro Pastoral Protagonism Initiative, which has the objective to expand the outreach of IPS, the Institute of Pastoral Studies, to the Hispanic populations to better reflect the shifting demographics of the church today. And simultaneously, lastly, I am currently doing an internship at an organization called Sant'Egidio, which is an international social justice organization that is in more than 70 countries around the world. And here in Chicago, we are dedicated to serve the homeless community. And we recently began a route to serve the newly arrived asylum seekers and migrant families. Thank you so much.
Wow. Thank you for sharing your path, Belen, and really for sharing your passion for perhaps those that don't have a voice. Thank you for your story. Chisa, let's go ahead and pivot over to you.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Chisa Santiago. I'm Puerto Rican, but I was born and raised right here in Chicago, the Bucktown neighborhood. I'm a product of the Chicago public school system. I started college right after high school, but about a year and a half into my college experience, really just didn't know what I wanted to do. I was unsure of a major, and I started to become discouraged. So I eventually left school and started working full time. In 2005, I found my calling and I became a Chicago police officer. I loved being the police. I was passionate and I was determined to advance. So in 2019, I was promoted to sergeant. And in 2020, I was given the opportunity to lead a group of officers that focused more on community policing versus your traditional policing. So what we were tasked to do was to just build relationships in the community, build back that trust between the community and the police, identify chronic issues within the community, and then collaborate with the stakeholders, with the residents, businesses in the community to come up with some sustainable solutions. During this time, I always felt like something was missing, and completing my degree was always in the back of my mind. I started looking into the tuition reimbursement programs through the Chicago Police Department, and Loyola offered a discount for CPD officers. But what was even more attractive was the School of Continuing and Professional Studies program for adult learners. Not only were they offering the flexibility and the convenience of online classes that I needed to juggle work, school, and home life, but they also offered a bachelor's in paralegal studies. I was reluctant to apply to Loyola because at this point, I had been out of school for about 20 years, but I took a leap of faith. I hit that submit button on my application and resumed my education. So fast forward 3 years, I am getting ready to graduate in May with my bachelor's degree in paralegal studies. I was awarded the President's Medallion. I was inducted into the Honor Society Alpha Sigma Lambda. I'm strongly considering pursuing my master's degree and focusing on advancing in my career to the rank of lieutenant.
Wow. Well, congratulations on coming back to school and obviously serving our local communities. You know, there's a number of themes that kind of come to mind when I hear all of your stories, and that's one of trials and setbacks, but more importantly, grit and resilience that all of you have shown within your journey. I'd love to just delve a little bit deeper into that. What would you say has been the biggest challenges inherent to your path so far? And how did you strengthen yourself to overcome them? And I guess I'd like to start with Chisa to maybe if you could delve a little bit further into that.
That's such a great question. So having to work harder than the next man, literally, to prove myself to others has probably been my biggest challenge. You know, I knew that being a police officer was going to be hard. It's a dangerous job. I figured most of my challenges would be dealing with the public. What I didn't anticipate was challenges I would have that came from within the department, from my own colleagues. It's a male-dominated profession, and sometimes they don't treat you the same as their male counterparts. I've had assumptions made about me because based on my physical appearance. I've had male officers tell me I should stick to desk duty. I've even had a high-ranking superior tell me to go home and cook dinner. It takes a lot of restraint to keep your cool in those situations and maintain your dignity. And sometimes those comments did get the best of me. But I used that skepticism as my motivation, and I made sure to apply myself, be proactive, take advantage of any opportunities presented in front of me. I set goals for myself, which led to my promotion. And eventually I stopped working to prove myself to others and started working to prove myself to me because it brought me fulfillment. And I just decided that I was going to have the mind frame of, you know, when I go to work, I show up with good intentions and a clear heart. And I think that when you do that, you can overcome any challenge and instinctively go down the right path.
Wow. Thank you for sharing. Clear minds, full hearts, Chisa. That's a tremendous amount of resilience there to navigate the complexity of that type of environment, especially an internal environment instead of external one. Thank you for sharing. Juanita, how about you?
Yeah, I think I agree. This is a great question. And while Chisa was talking, I was also thinking a little bit about my own path and what that has meant for me. And I think that as an immigrant, the main kind of challenge that I continue, and this is not something that I've been able to overcome, but it's kind of like I'm taking it as like it's going to be with me for life, is just missing home. Like I came when I was 19, and I came not because it was like my decision technically, like I needed to go to get a BA and this was like the better option. So I came, but that I never meant to leave, I guess. And so while I was in my first 4 years, I often, like whenever I could go back home, like I had the hardest time coming back because it was like, why, now that I'm here, why do I have to leave again? Why do I have to go back? So that's one of the things that has been kind of a big challenge in my life, just like reminding myself why I'm here and why this is worth it and why my life would look very different if I went back home. But I think that, yeah, it's just like, as I said, like for me, dealing with it more than overcoming it has been just reminding myself like what the goal here is. And I have been able to do that just like I talk to my grandma especially every day, but my dad has always been like the dreamer in our family. And every time that I have like this moments where I'm like, I just miss everything. I don't want to be here. I miss the food. I miss my family. I miss my culture. I miss dancing. He's always been like so clear with like our goal as a family. So having him kind of remind me like why we did this, why it made sense at the time, why does it still make sense, has been a way to deal with it. I think another challenge that I've seen in my path is figuring out visa situation. And I think that for a lot of us who are immigrants, that's always like just like a source of stress, I guess. I came with a student visa, but I knew that if I wanted to stay longer, I needed to get another type of visa. And it had happened that my sister had tried to stay in the United States, but she wasn't able to get her visa sponsored, so she had to go back. So when I was kind of in that process of graduating from my BA to figuring out what I was going to do, there was a lot of like pressure, a lot of stress on like how I was going to make it work. Because at the end of the day with the visa, there's a lot you can do, but there's a lot that is completely out of your hands. And I think that in this case, it was like me at a very young age by myself in this country, trying to figure out like all this paperwork, all these like legal forms that I had to sign and had to send. And I remember that there was like a crucial point, as I mentioned before, like the place that I used to work, in my mind took way too long to let me know that they were not going to be able to sponsor it. So then I was kind of like left by myself to figure it out. But I had one moment at work that I remember one of my supervisors, he had like an attorney that he was going to suggest that I use. And so I called the attorney and it was like one of the worst conversations that I've had in my life, because first, I couldn't afford it. Second, the person was like so condescending. And basically his answer was that I was going to get deported because I hadn't filled out one of the forms correctly. So I was like, in this office, like trying to act professional while at the same time, like figuring out that my whole world or the whole plan that my family and I had was like going to be just like completely gone because I hadn't filled out a form right. And so like I was just obviously like crying, and I remember going to the bathroom, and in the bathroom this person who worked with me, we weren't like super close friends, but like we were related, or we were friendly because we were both immigrants, and her family's from Guatemala, and she came and she was like, no, I'm gonna give you the contact of a lawyer that is going to work with you. He has worked with all of our family members. He is like the person that I recommend. He's affordable and all these things. And so I think that that moment of like feeling like finding some light in this like very terrible circumstance of like not knowing and being told that I was going to get deported and not knowing how to tell my parents and like all these things, there she was like giving me such a great kind of like advice in the form of like literally call this number and he'll figure it out for you. So, I think that I overcame that just by kind of just feeling my feelings, I guess. It's one of the ways that I would say, because like I it would have been very different if I had kept it silent, that like I was going through all of that and no one would have noticed in my place of work that I had something. And then also like leaning in other immigrants for help, like just asking or telling her my story, and she being able to give me a point of contact that ended up being the person who helped me pass from like my student visa to now the residency that I have. I think that that was like great, and those would be like the two main things that I think have been like the biggest challenges, just like dealing with missing home and this longing that I think like all immigrants have, and then figuring out a visa in the United States.
Thank you for sharing, Juanita. I think so many a times, including myself as an immigrant, we take for granted, you know, the right to be able to work and live and go about our lives here. And so you know, hearing, you know, your personal trial is something that kind of reminds us of the gratitude we should have. So thank you for sharing. Belen, why don't we talk a little bit more about what would you say are some of the challenges? You've mentioned a few, some pretty grave ones already, but you know, please share with us more, like what have been some of those biggest challenges that you've had to inherit so far in your own path?
Yes, of course. Thank you, Nicolas. I agree with Juanita. You know, for me, one of the biggest challenges has been my migration experience. It is one of my biggest life challenges. To begin, I did not even want to come to live in the United States when I was 13. I even asked my mom to leave me in Ecuador with my grandma, but thankfully she didn't listen and kept the whole family together. And so the process of adjustment is tough, you know, for a teenager, adjusting, or for everybody, right? Adjusting to a new life, a new country, language, school was challenging for me. Nonetheless, at 13, I had objectives. And one of them was to learn English in 7 months. I completely remember that saying to myself. And I was determined and I did it and continued to be a great student since then. Always, you know, I think one of the most important things is that desire to make my parents proud, you know, that there's a reason why we came here to the United States, and I want to be that reason. Another challenge for me has been my mom's illness. Certainly the biggest challenge of my life, I would say, challenging emotionally, and because it completely changed my educational and career goals at the time. Nevertheless, what has strengthened me during the most difficult times of my life has been my faith. It is hard to see an illness as a blessing. But once we are able to change that perspective, we can realize that everything has a purpose, even if we do not understand it. So I hang on to God very firmly with all my strength, and my burdens get lighter. Certainly, God's love has allowed me to carry on and carry my joy with me even through the toughest times. Very often people tell me that I make things look easy. And I say to them that it is because I never feel alone. I trust in God's plan in my life and in my mom's life and my family's life. Lastly, recently too, very challenging for my academic career has been, my dad has had three surgeries during my academic career for my master's, and it has been challenging. But what has kept me strong is, again, my family. We have worked together to overcome these difficulties and come out of them victorious.
Thank you, Belen. Thank you very, very much for sharing. I think, you know, just to summarize and recap what I've heard from you know, the three of you as it relates to challenges and setbacks. I mean, I think the big common theme is in times really challenging situations is really going back to just the overall self-reflection as leaders and thinking through your purpose and thinking through your why and the faith that all of you have put on each other, you know, in yourselves is pretty remarkable. You know, believing yourself is again, goes back to that theme of grit and resilience that obviously is reflective in all of your character. Let's go ahead and pivot a little bit further into your views on the importance of mentorship and sponsorship in your professional path. Belen, why don't we start with you? Could you maybe share with us any positive experiences around mentorship and sponsorship in your own trajectory?
Definitely, Nicolas, I think this is a really important question. I believe mentorship is extremely necessary for everybody that is, you know, right now, thinking of their educational career, professional career. In my case, I would like to mention three important mentors and sponsors. One of them is Elena Segura. She is the senior coordinator of Pastoral Migratoria. And I learned so much from her, you know, like her professional skills and her spirituality and her determination. So she has been a very important inspiration for me in terms of my vocation and the path that I am taking now, as I was able to work with her for three years and learn from her. So one more recent mentor, and shout out to Professor Michael Canaris. He's an associate professor of ecclesiology and systematic theology and the co-director of the Miguel Pro Pastoral Protagonism Initiative of the IPS that I had mentioned before. He really has guided me and motivated me to go farther than I could have imagined during my academic career. This past summer, I was able to go to the Rome program that the IPS has. And I went to study, you know, it's 10 days, the program is 10 days. But I extended my stay and stayed in Italy for 2 months. He guided me he put me in contact with the Lay Center. The Lay Center is a important institution for students in Rome, for lay students, those that are not wanting to be priests, but lay students that are studying theology and et cetera. I was able to go, and I got a scholarship to go to a leadership formation program there, which was amazing. And because of him, I was able to go there. You know, he put me in contact with the right people, and it has been life-changing, you know. The program taught me a lot more skills to be a leader. And in addition to that, Professor Canaris also put me in contact with the community of Sant'Egidio in Rome. The community of Sant'Egidio was founded in Rome, and is one of the biggest institutions in Rome for the help of all types of vulnerable populations, such as disabled, homeless, migrants, refugees, poor, you know, ill, you name. So I was able to go there and volunteer with them for those for like a month and a half in Rome. And now, because of that, I am here in Chicago, again, with Sant'Egidio, doing work with the homeless population here in Chicago. So I have brought what I learned from Rome to Chicago. And that is all thanks to Professor Michael Canaris. And lastly, I'm going to say Dr. Peter Jones, the interim dean of the IPS. He has been a great mentor and a sponsor for me, because thanks to him and the IPS faculty, you know, I've been able to receive scholarships that have funded half of my academic program, which I could not be sitting here if it wasn't for the scholarships that the IPS granted me.
Wow, incredible. You mentioned a couple of organizations that you're involved with, and we actually have a question here in the audience from Jennifer Coselion. She would like to know, what was the name of the immigrant organization that you mentioned, and how could one potentially get involved to volunteer?
Definitely, yes. The name is in Italian, so is Sant'Egidio. Is a S-A-N-T apostrophe E-G-I-D-I-O, and pronounced Sant'Egidio. In Chicago, we are a small organization. In Rome, is huge, but here we're growing, and I can give you my contact information later through Nicolas, so you anybody who would like to join us can do it. So I would be glad to talk to you more about that after this panel. Yes.
Great. Thank you, Belen. All right, let's pivot on to Chisa. Chisa, love to hear more about, you know, mentors or sponsors that have kind of helped shape your career to this date.
Yeah, I think it's really, really, really important to have mentorship and sponsorship. You know, when I came on the job, I right away was looking for, you know, the women that looked like me. But overall, there's just not a lot of Latinas in the department, much less Latina supervisors. So I had to keep an open mind and embrace whoever was willing to support me. And I was fortunate enough to work under two really great sergeants who mentored me and gave me great leadership examples. I just gravitated towards them because they had, you know, the work ethic that I aspired to have, and they were full of knowledge and experience. I think it's also important to look at yourself as a mentor. As a sergeant and a veteran officer, I try to put myself out there for the younger officers to encourage them and let them know that I am a resource for them, especially the younger Latina generation. You just never know who's watching you and who you can inspire.
Thank you for sharing. It's kind of remarkable that, you know, you talk about those that have mentored you or sponsored you along the way, and how you're looking to pay it forward, which is, you know, what we're here to do. So thank you for sharing. Juanita, how about you? Could you maybe share with us maybe some of your mentors or sponsors along your path?
Yeah, of course. I do want to say, by the way, too, that I love Chisa's point of being or thinking about yourself as a mentor as we continue developing our careers and everything. Because I think it's so important, and we might be the person that we were looking to find before in our lives. So I agree with that. But yeah, let me first start by saying I think having mentors is crucial, but not only for like one's professional career. I think that in life, having mentors for everything is great. And so I'm just gonna give a few examples of other mentors that are outside of my professional career that I think are so important to me. But I think that in my case, I grew up with four women in our house. My dad was the only man. And this like solidarity that we have built, obviously by living together, being family, but also by being very conscious about our own experiences as women and how my grandma can teach us, how my mom can teach us, has been so important in my life. And I think that part of the way that obviously like we enter a space, we're always going to be perceived as women. We're always going to be perceived as Latinas, but being able to kind of speak to someone that is so close to me, that knows me so well about kind of that, how to just be in those spaces or kind of live through that has been great. So having that type of mentorship is very important to me. And also mentorship in spirituality. Hearing Belen speaking reminded me of one of my favorite people in the world. She passed, her name was Sister Margaret Kiefer, but she was a sister from Rochester, Minnesota, a Franciscan sister from Rochester, Minnesota, that lived in my high school in Bogota. And this person was like 90, I don't know when I was like in school, but she was the person that like you would see her going above and beyond to just like be at the service of everyone. And like, regardless of her age, regardless of her own kind of limitations in walking and in doing, she was always present. And she was always kind of like the visible image of God that I think that we're always kind of like looking for. So I think that that was also another mentorship of like how to be in my spirituality in a way that feels authentic and feels organic to me. So that's another aspect that I wanted to mention to kind of give an example of why I think that mentors in every aspect of your life matter. And I also want to say that that's part of having, like, I don't think of, even in speaking about kind of professional career now, I don't think that it's sufficient to only have like one mentor. I think that I would have mentors, like many mentors, because I think that there's, even in our professional careers, people have different expertise. And so, for instance, I remember I have like a person that I go for like financial questions, because this is my first time having a credit card and having a credit score and all these things. I go to someone for like financial questions. I go to someone else for like research questions. And I think that being able to kind of like identify like the strengths in people and what I could really like lean in for is kind of really important. And to finish just with like one of my positive experiences at school, I think that I do want to speak about Dr. Mariak Shooting. So Dr. Mariak Shooting is an environmental sociologist in our department. I met her because we were paired my first year in graduate school. So 4 years ago, since my first year, I was paired to be her research assistant. And since that moment, like, she's become one of the, as I said, like one of the reasons why I am at Loyola. And I think that a couple of things that are so impactful in my life that I have received from her, aside of just like advice on finishing that paper or like publishing on journals, it's just like how to be a human in this space. Because I think that a lot of the times we get kind of caught up in like questions or advice that is like very specific and strategic, but also just like seeing someone be the type of person that you want to be in this position is really cool. And for her, or with her, I had moments, so we've been working together since, and I've gone through moments where I, like, for instance, in during the pandemic 2021, Colombia was in a national strike. There was a lot of things happening in my country, and I was kind of being pulled from every side, because on one hand I had like papers to finish and I had like presentations to do at school, and on the other hand it was me like not falling asleep because I was thinking about what was happening in my country, and like always, or at during that time, being so kind of emotionally charged with a lot of things. And with her, it was just like I didn't know if it was like combining too much of like just letting her know where I was at in my life in general, because she's a professor and like the RA ship is kind of like delineated as like you're doing research for them, and kind of that's where the boundaries are drawn. But as I began kind of sharing with her just like my experiences and what I was going through, it felt so like just like comfortable that she was like not even like second guessing if this was like a conversation that we should have or why we should have it, but just like making me feel so comfortable talking to her, making me feel so safe talking to her. And now looking back, it's like, that's what I want to be for someone younger. Like when they have these type of problems that we often think of, like, this is not part of work, but like you cannot bring things to work, if you're like, if this is happening in your life, it's coming to you everywhere, and being able to like make a space for people to say, like, you don't have to act like you are not yourself when you're at work or when you're at school. Like, you can come with your problems, with your concerns, with your fears, with your like whatever joys. I think it's very important. So I think that that's have been one of the best experiences I've had in terms of mentorship, just seeing someone that is so like ready to listen, so ready to make like a safe space for me, and also so humble with everything. Like, she's one of the persons that I, because in academia too, I feel like we often have like people with a lot of like, as we are kind of instructed to make arguments and to be experts, like a lot of people develop egos that then are like hard to go or navigate. But then with her, it's like, she's one of the most knowledgeable persons I know. She's one of the most well-read persons I know, but yet she's so humble with the way that she like goes about everything. So that is just like, I'm in awe every time I'm around her. I love being around her. I love her as a person, as a professor, as a mentor. I cannot say enough of how much she means to me.
Thank you, Juanita. I think the big theme around sponsorships and mentorships is really, you know, despite whatever setbacks we may have, we shouldn't suffer in silence. There appears to be somebody that's there to listen and to help be our temperature gauger, and it's good to hear that. You know, so much of where you all have come from is a product of those relationships that have formed you. All right, we're getting close to the end of time here. Next question: how do you ensure that you're growing? Any routines or rituals? I'll kind of hand it off to Juanita to kick us off there.
This is an interesting question. I guess I haven't thought about it in this sense, like how am I ensuring that I'm growing? But something that I can share that I'm very proud of myself for is starting therapy. I think that we often in the Latina community, we don't think that we need therapy, and we act like our family pressures, and as an immigrant too, like this is all normal, this is everyone is going through it, so like I'm just gonna go through it. But I think that once I started realizing that the load of just the graduate program itself mixed with all of these things that I had of my own life and like the longing to be back home and like my own experiences as a Latina woman in this country, all those things, like I needed someone that would be there for me to help me kind of like navigate this and keep myself grounded while growing. And I think that that was, yeah, as I said, one of the things that I'm most proud of. I started going to therapy. It was also very fun to go into that process of like choosing the therapist that I would see, because I wanted to make sure that it was a person who would understand some of my experiences. And so my therapist is an immigrant Latina woman. We speak in Spanish, which was very important for me. But all, just like making time for my mental health, making time for just like prioritizing my need to be like accompanied in some moments where I don't like my very close people are not going to have like the best advice on or like the best lens to look at this. But having someone that is like trained to do that has been very important for me. I think also just to keep growing, I put a lot of emphasis on just like exposure to different realities. In the work that I do, I almost always use qualitative methodologies. That means that I'm interviewing people, I'm doing ethnographies, and being able to like observe a neighborhood where I don't live, but being able to kind of immerse myself and understand it from people who live there, from their perspective, or just engage in conversations where like women feel so comfortable to tell me so much about their lives, has met or has impacted me in ways that have meant a lot of growth in the way that I perceive myself, in the way that I think of my privileges, my oppressions, the way that I understand society. Yeah, it has been a lot of growth through just exposure. And then last but not least, I think reading. I mean, we all do this for our own purpose, but I think reading, when it's something that you're passionate about and that is contributing to your research interest, I think that that's also a way of growing. And that's something I also keep in mind as part of my routine.
Thank you. Thank you, Juanita. Belen, how do you ensure that you're continuously growing? What are some routines or rituals that you carry out?
Thank you. Yes, thank you for including this specific question. It's really good. For me, being intentional is one of the most important ways I measure my growth. When we are intentional, we're able to be active listeners, which is the single most important quality of a leader. Sometimes I've struggled with that. So every time I am intentional when listening to someone, I notice that I am strengthening that quality. Another way is my ability to be understanding. Every time I face an argument or a conflict, being understanding by putting myself in the other person's shoes is one of the best ways to manage this difficult situations. So this doesn't mean avoiding conflict, because conflict in many instances actually leads to resolutions and growth, but making an effort to see through the eyes of the other person, it's very good to understand the situation with a new perspective. So every time I do that, I notice that, you know, I'm growing a little more as a person. And lastly, I like to do self-reflections and self-evaluations often. I make time to reflect on my actions and decisions to better understand myself and others. This is important because at the end of the day, those actions and decisions shape your life and the way that people see you.
Awesome. Awesome. Yeah, I heard themes around intentionality, self-reflection, empathy. Empathy being so important to personal professional growth. Chisa, how about you? What are some of the things that you do to constantly challenge yourself, you know, and make sure that you're continuously growing?
Yeah, similar to Juanita and Belen, just checking in with myself regularly, whether it's mentally, spiritually, physically, especially when things start to feel mundane, just ask myself, is there something else I could be doing? Is there something else I'd like to be doing? If so, reevaluating, seeking other opportunities. I think it's super important to show myself kindness and compassion. Sometimes I've judged myself too harshly, and that takes away from my confidence and my courage. So just reminding myself to be kind to myself. And then just always having gratitude for where I'm at now and how far I've come. You're on mute, Nico.
Thank you, Chisa. I was saying thank you for your candor. I think, you know, we're running a little bit short on time. And so I kind of would like to open it up for questions from the audience. Just as we close off here, I just want to just preface this by saying thank you to all three of you for sharing your stories. They have been incredibly inspiring. You know, I think your humility and openness, you know, at least for me, propels a lot of self-reflection as to, you know, how I should think about tomorrow. And I want to thank you all for that. I think there's this other common theme around all of your paths that have been challenging around really being open to growth, but more in doing so as a pursuit of purpose and purpose and service to others, which is incredibly inspiring. So thank you for living that Ignatian principle of committed to doing justice for everyone. All right, here we have a question from an anonymous attendee. What words of wisdom to close things off could you share with fellow students that helped you on your journey?
I can go. Don't be afraid to ask for help. and allow yourself grace. Things don't go exactly as planned. Things don't go the way, you know, you would have done them, or you know, you have to do them multiple times before you get it right or whatever. But allow yourself grace.
Thank you, Chisa.
I can go next. Two things. One is do what gives you peace. Do what gives you peace. And the second is take time to make your decisions. You know, take a few days. Listen to yourself and confirm those decisions with yourself. Because you will know exactly where you are being called when you feel a little fire in your heart. And to feel that little fire in your heart, you have to be very, you have to be listening to yourself.
Awesome. Thank you, Belen. It sounds like you're doing a lot of active listening, not only with others, but also with yourself. Juanita, why don't you close us out?
Yes, I'm going to close with something that that I think is also needed. Remember to have fun. I think that often we get into like the nitty-gritty of like the everyday, what we have to do every hour. But something that has helped me just endure the everything that has happened, the many years of the PhD and all these things, is just like finding moments to have fun and being feeling, what's the word? How do you say, guiltless? Not feeling guilty about just prioritizing your fun too. Because I think that something that I am reminded by my parents, my professors, is I don't want to think about this part of my life as like for the past 10 years, all I did was read, all I did was study. I want to remember that in my youth, I also had fun. I also went dancing. I mentioned dancing is a very important part in my life. I love going dancing. So, and that brings me so much joy. That brings me like a restoration that I would not be able to do the projects that I do. I would not be able to show up the way that I show up if I wasn't kind of also making sure that I have my energy and that I have my joy.
Thank you. Thank you, Juanita. And I think with that, I will leave it there. I want to thank everybody that attended this evening, but more importantly, our three Latina Trailblazers, the President's Medallion recipients. It has truly been an incredible hour getting to hear your stories, your walks of life. Thank you so much for your humility and openness to share. In terms of just closing it out, I want to share this link with everybody here. This is our link tree of everything happening within the Loyola University Latino Alumni Board. We have a basketball game coming up. You know, one of the biggest reasons we do this is we're, until last year, we were the only alumni affinity group that has a scholarship that we, on a quarterly basis, give back to current students in need through this scholarship endowment. So please, if you want to make a donation to our scholarship endowment, I encourage you to do so. And yeah, and I think as membership, we will look to have some sort of event in person in the coming months. Once we get out of this cold a little bit, it'd be lovely to meet all of you in person and meet some of our audience members. So thank you, everybody. Thank you, Chisa, Belen, Juanita. It has truly been a pleasure. Muchísimas gracias y buenas noches.
Gracias.